Greetings everybody, this is Thungon. I am here in my single player world doing a little bit of a world tour. I decided to go with touring 5 bases that I've built over the past 2 years. This is not one of them, this is actually the very beginning of my world. This is my very first house, like 4 years ago. And yeah, let's get to it, don't want to waste too much time. I just wanted to start here to kind of indicate where all the other stuff is in my world and how it's structured. That's where my doghouse was, and my dog that vanished into the oblivion. My first ever tree farm. So yeah, 2 years has passed since I think this was last recorded on. There's my slime farm, there's the volcano, but we're going actually going to go this way. To a base I built in release 1.6-ish, I think. It would have to be. I think it broke in 1.7. And of course I spawn up here. I have feather falling, so we should be good. Let's get out of here. So yeah, this is my 1.6 base. Some parts of it are laggy right now. But the first thing built in this area was this, and this is a very overpowered farm, and it's an iron farm. It was built by Tango Tech originally. This is the first design of one of his many designs, and it's really, really crazy. You can see a lot of doors, like a lot of doors in there. So you can see them all the way down. And what this build did, combined all these doors into... I really needed, like... ender pearls or something right now. poor planning. But what this area did was combined a bunch of doors into 32 villages. And iron golems spawned in the water, which is in the middle of all the villages. Fell down here. Died in the lava and gave me a ton of iron. You can see this is my first chest of iron blocks and 2 stacks of anvils just because there was a ton of iron here. So all the iron was actually moved to another part of this area over there. But that was one of the last things built. So the second thing built in this area was this. Huge, giant, enormous portals. Another portals to spawn... zombie pigmen in the overworld. So this is the overworld zombie pigment farm. The pigments spawn in the portals, fall down into the water streams we were just in, and die at the bottom. Their jobs get caught into here. You can see that the gold goes into there, and the zombie flesh goes into this pillar of chests. And yeah, this is all the gold that is. The gold is not moved, but 9 stacks of gold. Blocks of gold is pretty solid amount of gold. This wheat farm sustained me for the entirety of 2 years. I always use it. It gives me exactly 1.5 stacks of bread, which is awesome. Let's get some blocks. There we go. And since these farms actually take a lot of time to actually spawn the golems. This actually spawned a golem like once every 3 minutes, and that spawned pigmen at a okay rate. It's not as good as some other zombie pigmen farms, but it works. So to spend time here, I built this, and this is actually, no matter what size, what that looks like and what the portals look like, this is the most overpowered farm in the whole entire game. I say that all the time and I stand by it. It is an AFK fishing farm. So what you do is put like a weight on your mouse, or I could use caps lock to mimic holding down the right mouse button. That way you're permanently fishing. So you fill up your inventory like this, grab a fishing rod, or just stand, and then you stand here. And then like you're continuously holding right mouse, but the iron door doesn't let you recast the fishing line. So the tripwire detects when you catch a fish, and then it opens the iron door briefly so you can catch it. And then it goes again and again and again for like all 8 hours that you're sleeping or whatever you want. And then this dispenser dispenses fishing rods when you break yours, etc., etc. And it's the most overpowered farm in the game because you get all those enchanted books. I've never had to enchant a bow. This is just combining bows that dropped from this farm. You can see kind of, this is all the junky items from it. And these are all the plain fishing rods that dropped. But I should showcase this area first because we're going to move on. But also I kind of just flattened out this whole area. This used to be very kind of mountains. You can see where the trees were originally. I left the trees here as a kind of for future plans, but never got around to them. But I wanted to keep the trees there so I could kind of extend them back down to the ground as it is, and kind of make this area more flat in general. And here are my graves. I liked making graves for like diamond picks and whatnot. The first diamond picks in this world, etc. So here lies the first iron golem that this farm spawned. The iron golem farm spawned in 1.7 hit. The farm stopped working, and this is the last iron golem. Here's the first guardian. That's one of the bases we're going to explore today. Here lies the first squid, which is in the same base as the guardian. And the first pigman. I think it's from that gold farm or a different gold farm. We're going to see both today, and there's the first one. And this is kind of cool. I have a ton of beacons, but I took them out, but you could kind of imagine what this would look like if all of the beacons were in place, with the red and white stripes, and then half of it, about halfway up and about halfway there, it turns into blue and white. So you kind of imagine it would turn into the American flag if it was complete and I didn't need the beacons for like actual beacon towers like that. So yeah, basic sheep, cow farm. What else is in this area? Ah, yes, this is my little enchanting table. These are all picks I can't repair anymore. I'm keeping them all just in case Mojang decides to actually let them be repairable again. It's one of the changes that I disagree with and I talked about in my return video. So yeah, this tree thing, I think the trees are lagging me, or item frames inside the trees, or all the chests inside. But this area is the laggiest place in my world. Consistently drops me down to this jittery you see. It's kind of this bad, but whatever. So this is my fishing loot. You can see why I never need to enchant a bow again in this world. And why I never need to get like feather falling or depth strider again, just from raw enchanting table stuff. Yeah, fishing is blatantly overpowered. This is one of my favorite chests. You could see all the name tags you get from fishing and lily pads, neither of which are renewable resources, except for AFK fishing or fishing in general. So that's just like, I never need a name tag again. I always can name whatever I want. My favorite fish in the game, the puffer fish, that shape. Saddles, now we need saddles again. Definitely not. All sorts of regular fish. Leather boots, even though I always wear my... I typically run around like this, but I fought withers recently, so I put this on, but... this is all you really need. For regular survival, or at least well-developed survival worlds. And all my wither fights actually take place down below. The staircase here. So yeah, let's go up more. Here's the underground, the iron for the beacon that we saw, the quad beacon upstairs. And here's actually, I call this deep space storage, but I actually defunct this area, or got rid of it. But you can see, iron blocks. I'll never need iron again. Iron farms are pretty strong. Basically just storage for kind of bulk materials that you get just playing in the world. Zombie flesh, etc., etc. A little bit of smelting and all that sorts of stuff in the space. So this space is one of the most well-developed areas of my world. It would only be comparable to sign fields, as I call it, the glass dome base you saw in the return video, if you watched it, which is a beta 1.8 base. And the last thing in this area is just an ice tray. It freezes ice, and then you can collect it. So we could go up there if we really want, and I'll cut to the next space. But yeah, this is a crazy area. Actually, it gets a nice view. That road right there kind of leads to a failed project of mine that I kind of wanted to do, but didn't really have interest in the long run. Oh, the top of that is actually a nice circle of stained green glass, and that's another failed project. Don't ignore that thing. But I love that. I wish it would actually like let me run around on, but kind of see here the ice freezes right here. If it wasn't completely full, and then pistons. There. That's what freezes. The pistons will push it up to here, and then this piston will push it in, and then it forms a giant ice cube. This is kind of Ethos design. I modified it a lot. There's a creeper in there even. And obviously it has flaws still, with this ice should definitely not be ice. But hey, kitten. We have a kitten where we live now. Harrison, very curious kitten. He's right here. So yeah, let's go to the next base. Alright, so we're back in the Nether. Just came through the iron farm portal, as you could see in the iron on the ground. I kind of labeled the portals based on what's at each location. So this portal will lead to a melon and tree farm, as you can imagine. It's actually really close to the 1.6 base here, the iron farm. This leads to a gardening farm. We're gonna see that next, but I want to showcase. That leads to my end portal. But I want to showcase this right here. This is actually pretty recent. And we'll see it right here. But it's a horse area, horse farm. So it's not a farm because I'm not really farming horses. But oh, I did bring some golden saddles from the old base that we just at. Oh, and actually there's some prismarine. So this was built after the guardian farm. But here we have one of each type of horse. Let's go up and see this. So we have one of each type of horse in the game. There is 35 different breeds. We have white horses, creamy horses, chestnut horses. These are the official names Mojang gave. Brown, dark brown, gray, and black. And then so those are the seven colors that the horses can be, and then each horse can have either plain colors, white legs. You can see that the legs are actually white horses, hard to see, but you can see the white legs on each horse compared to those. What's it called? White field as it's called. It's kind of these cow spots. And then these Dalmatian spots, white dots on each of the seven colors, and then black specks. I think these are actually my names, black specks and whatnot, white field. But you can see one of each type of horse. And it's pretty awesome. And these are all my failed attempts. These are actually all trained horses for the most part. I don't really ride horses around in my world, I just did this for the fun of it. This is actually kind of funny. There's a jungle temple with no jungle around. So yeah, this is kind of. I would get excited to see what I did to this world up there, but this is just a little base I did, kind of the second of the five I'm going to showcase today. So we go back to the Nether, and then I'll show you the Guardian farm. Let me enter the Nether all laggy and show you. So the Guardian Farm is down this tunnel. It is very long tunnel. Oh, kitty, you can't sit behind me or climb my on my head. Okay. So I'm gonna cut this tunnel out. Alright, so we're arriving at the end. This is the third area, or well-developed area in my world I'm gonna showcase. There are actually three portals in this area that are unlabeled at the moment, but I kind of figured it out in the long run. So we have that one, and then two in here. So one here and one here. And I want to go through this one first to kind of show you one of my favorite scenes I've ever, like, views I've ever seen in Minecraft. At least, vanilla generation. So actually in a jungle, and it's an amplified jungle. And amplified jungles are beautiful. So let's climb up here the best we can with pearls. So this area right here, it's kind of a valley inside the amplified jungle. All the way to here is actually supposed to be air, and it is air. These are not water source blocks. The water source blocks are actually on the second block in. So in this column that I'm swimming in, are the water source blocks, and the water sources are flowing into this airspace, and then flowing straight down because they have nowhere else to go, and then they go beneath the ground of the farm, so it doesn't actually go inside of it. And the fact that these are air and these are air, or these are flowing water and then kind of air blocks, they don't form new sources, and they don't flood the whole area. So these glass pillars are actually needed to have these sheer water walls. Not sure if you can manipulate it enough to get rid of those entirely, but just having the wall, sheer water walls, are just amazing. And you could see, if you were paying attention and kind of asking questions, you can see this minecart track going all the way around the bottom of it. And that's because this water wall actually provides a really good source of squids. So the squids spawn and they swim to the edge of this water wall, and then they fall, and then they land on these house slabs, then die because they can't breathe in air. And then a minecart, oh, there it is. The minecart goes all the way around a hopper minecart, picking up the ink sacks, depositing them in these hoppers here, and these go into the storage. So it's a combination of a guardian farm. You can see all the guardians in here, these crazy little spiky fish. They all spawn in the water here, and then they flow down, and then they flow in the center, and then they fall through four sources of lava, or four layers, or three or four layers of lava, and then land on these hoppers, and then die, and then you get their drops, and all their drops are in here. This is the hoppers that lead to the squid area. So the ink sacks come into here, and this is an item sorter by Zazuma Void, I think. And so the drops come through here, and if it's fish, it goes passes by, but if it's not fish, it goes to the next one. Into here, Prismarine shards, so the fish and shards come through here, the fish go down, the shards continue to go down here instead. The Prismarine crystals pass through both, and then go to here, and then so on and so forth, to ink sacks. I just crafted all this sort of stuff this morning, so it looks empty, but I guarantee you it's not. Hi, kitten. These are all the ink sacks. And these are all the dark papers. These are all a sack of ink and 8 stacks of these leads to 1 sack of these. So you can kind of see how I compressed all of these into what we see here. And then, of course, there's a billion raw fish that I have no use for. So yeah, that's this small area. There's a quad beacon up above. there's a mini jungle tree farm here. Ooh, my voice is cracking. Mini jungle tree farm. I used the farm jungle wood. This is actually one of my favorite beacon setups. It's a quad beacon, and each beacon has 4 layers of iron blocks around it. So this beacon right here, this corner one, has a 3x3 right here, and this one uses the same iron as this one, except for these three. So you kind of see how each of these beacons have a 3x3, but since they're all next to each other, you could get a 4x4 and have all 4 beacons here. So a solitary beacon, to have a 4-layer beacon for a single one, you need 2 stacks plus 36 iron blocks. And for a quad beacon, you need 3 stacks plus 24 instead of the 2 stacks times 4. So you're saving like 3 times on the amount of iron that you would normally just by combining beacons like this. And you can see I have all the iron in the world, so it doesn't really matter too much, but yes, but so efficiency, right? And the 4 effects I have is haste 2, strength 2, and then you can only get 1 level of regeneration. Actually, what is going on? Where's the resistance? Resistance is acting up. Oh, that's not. Oh, oops. Good thing I don't really need resistance much. But I have haste 2, strength 2, and resistance 2. Come on. There we go. So haste 2, strength 2, resistance 2. And then on the last beacon, you could get speed 2. But instead, which one is it? This one. You could get speed 2, but instead I get a point of regeneration instead, which you could only get from the 4th beacon level. So, yeah. Just making sure I have a little bit of regeneration. And you can see I never fully fill up on food on the bottom. I always leave it one and a half haunches low. And that's so every point of heart regeneration I take is actually through beacons instead of through food. And that saves on a lot of food, because food is so expensive. There you saw it. But I went through the effort of saving a guardian, elder guardian in this world. I saved it from this, the temple that was here at the very beginning. And I have a cow here to give me milk, to get rid of this mining fatigue. But I named it Moonkin, after a TF2 friend. And yeah, I have one here. I wanted to save all three, as you can tell here. This one's kept here by the water currents pushing him in the middle, so he can't really escape. Yeah, these huge things are pretty awesome. I don't want it to zap me though. So I saved that in the world, and that was a pain. The way to get into the temple without, or to destroy the temple, I actually used portals to transport them out. I built a portal inside the temple, and then it took you to this portal in the Nether, and then I moved him through the Nether, which is 8 times less distance than the overworld, through this portal instead, using slime blocks. Slime blocks are the only blocks you could break in place with this mining fatigue, because you could just one punch them. So you use a lot of those to kind of clear the area, get inside the temple without mining, with mining fatigue. You use TNT for that as well, and the milk clears that effect. But yeah, that's enough for the third area, so let's go to the fourth. Alright, so we're back through the tunnel. And the fourth area is actually inside the Nether itself, and it's at the end of this track, which is pretty short. You can see we're at the top of the Nether, the bedrock ceiling here, and I used beds to blow up a tunnel through all this Netherrack. This used to all be Netherrack, so I used a ton of beds to blow up all of this around. And I used a potion of fire resistance, and you place the bed, this is the most important, you place the pillow of the bed against a block, so that way you don't blow yourself up in the process. But the Nether base is actually this direction, and it is where I farm withers, and it's actually pretty dangerous, so might as well put this on. You can see that the half stab's already coming into play, so the whole base Nether around the fortress you're going to is all half slabbed up. And this is to stop pigmen and stuff from spawning up in these sort of caves, these Nether caves. You could see a three beacon, not a quad beacon, just three. And this is my actual way down. To help stay alive, the regen, the strength, the resistance, these are all crucial. You don't really need haste too down here, so that's why I don't have the fourth. But this is my Nether fortress. You can see that all the things that are not Nether fortress are as half stabbed as best as I could, or as much as I wanted to. I spend most of my time farming down here in this area. You can see all of this is half slabbed. And go around farming these guys. I have a looting 3 sword, and you just want their skulls, and that's what gets me all the beacons. You kind of see how many are spawning already, and these are typical rates. It's not automatic. Oh, I got one! Aha! Haha! Without looting even, that's awesome. These are the most furious things. The blazes. The blazes spawn like crazy now for some reason, and they do that, and then you burn. And then I regen with the resistance, I actually ate too much. Oops. I regen with the beacon a lot here, because I go through bread so fast anyways. If I used food to regenerate all the hearts here, I would need to like go back home like every 5 minutes just to refill up on bread. It food's that crazy and that broken right now. That's what I mean by you're either in the PvP extremes in one way you don't need food at all, or the way it currently is where you need a buffet just to stay alive. And up here I used the nether oak, the dark oak log trick before it was patched to break through the bedrock. And appear is actually a really powerful farm. You can see I'm level 61, and that is because of the farm appear. Speaking of which, you saw already a guardian farm, an iron farm, the nether portal gold farm. What else? What other crazy farms did we see? Oh, kitty. Kitty's on my lap right now. But this farm, as well, I get a ton more gold from this farm, but the thing is I don't spend a lot of time up here. I spent more time building it than I spent AFK here, I think. But this is a gold farm. You AFK here. I have to stop petting the kitty now because I don't need to get on the mouse. But you snowballs. And that's... Oh, you can see they're mad. So yeah, if the pigmen are mad, they chase you, and then they chase you down into here. And then they go into here, and then the pistons will kill them. And the pigman that stays mad is this one right here. He actually has a name. Moo Cow. Hi, Moo Cow. How are you doing? So you can see that they're still mad. And the changes to their AIs make them permanently mad. And they chase you when they're mad. So you could abuse this by going to the top of the nether where they spawn really, really fast. Because the only place they can spawn is in these on these stone brick. And then you ride a minecart. And then when you're over here, they're all spawning. And then the minecart moves. And then they all see you. And then they start chasing you. And then you could re-anger this one. The snowballs make that pigman take no health loss, but still get angry. You can see they're all chasing now. And then they're all dying. And then when you go back, you can see how the experience kind of pushes out towards me. And then I get all the experience and all their drops, their gold, and their gold ingots and stuff go into the hoppers beneath their feet. And we get more of the experience going back because we're heading slower. But you can see that all the new spawns are already spawned, and then they're all chasing me. Then they'll all fall into their little thing once I'm on this side of them. And then, yeah, you just stay here. And then, like, in 2 hours, you have 100 levels. Yeah, really powerful farm. But I still would say that the fishing farm is still the most powerful farm in the game. Despite how easy this is, it takes very little redstone to kind of keep them in place. And then you just stop whenever you want. And you can see zombies also spawn in here. I guess they do that. But... And this is where all it ends up. All the golden swords end through here. This is another item sorter, like the guardian farm. Their items come up through here. You can see the flesh, the swords, the ingots, the nuggets. That sort of stuff come up through here and then enters here. And it slides across either into the nuggets, the ingots, or the flesh. You can see that it's actually full of flesh, despite the very little time spent up here. And see a ton of ingots, and this is all the gold I got from this farm so far. So not a huge amount, but still, it's pretty crazy powerful farm for what it is. But let's go down. So I'm going to go all the way back into the fifth area now. Okay, so we're back to here. That's where the nether area is, and that's where the other bases we saw so far are. If you go along this track, we'll get to the fifth area. It's very short. We're taking a left, like, right here. And we already saw it in the return video, but I actually wanted to point out these are actually pretty cool custom rails. They're custom models, so they make the rails look 3D. And I think they look beautiful. So yeah, my resource pack like the green inventory, green beds and whatnot. Those are all custom. Custom things I've built over all the years. But this is my final area. It is a witch farm in progress. You can see the quad beacon, the typical setup here with the four furnaces and the stuff around. I actually had to do this twice, and I think I might have to do it a third time, because we saw a spider in there the first time, and the only witch is supposed to spawn in there, and the updates of this game actually kind of destroy old witch farm, or old witch huts, so they're not a proper witch hut anymore, they're just regular terrain and swamps. And you want a witch hut to have only witches spawn inside. And we can see the spider already kind of messing up. So, but these are the actual the witch huts I tore down so far. And these are the first witches that died to build those graves in the other area. So you can see all the supplies for the witch hut are in here. And then I have to regenerate these chunks freshly to get a fresh witch farm. Big sea witches, they drop down. I am getting a lot of witches. I think it might be only the top layer. Maybe the farm is built wrong. It's something to test over time, but I don't have high enough rates to do that yet. But you can see from witches, you get sticks, gunpowder. Special things are redstone and glowstone. Very difficult things to get normally. And spider eyes are pretty annoying to get, because spider farms are pretty tricky to build a spider spawner. And glass bottles. You get a lot of water bottles from fishing. Oh, and yeah, bottles are also 3D. Which are cool. Yeah, glowstone and redstone. These are farmable supplies now. And then I want to... It's really slow right now because there's a lot of terrain up top and a lot of caves around. And this farm actually takes a lot of time to set up because you need to set up a perimeter. And the perimeter is a really old method of mob farms where you start at a center area and then you go 128 blocks in each direction and then light up everything inside that perimeter. So it's 256 diameter square and you light up everything. So the ground is all lit up, so at nighttime they can't spawn on mobs, like zombies and stuff can't spawn on the surface, and light up every cave inside. And this is actually 110 blocks, this wall, so I need to go to like the end of this cobble, I think, and light up everything, so only witches are spawning in this area, no other, because witches, they're part of the regular hostile mob cap. And so if there are other hostile mobs around, witches won't be spawning at all. And nothing will be spawning inside there. So you need to light up everything. And with witch huts, there's actually another level on top of that. You can see with all of this going on, the flooding. In swampland, slime spawn from Y64 to 70-ish. And slimes are actually part of the hostile mob cap. And you can't light it up. You actually have to flood the area or get rid of it in some way. So this is what I'm doing in this area, is flooding it all over here. This quadrant is the most flooded area so far, but like other over here is, there's like three different biomes in this area. It's pretty awesome. And I have plans to utilize that. But we have the taiga over here, dark oak over here, and the swamp. So we have to get rid of at least all this swamp area. But we can maybe leave all of this if we just light it up, because slimes won't spawn in this taiga, the biome in the F3 screen. But what I want to do is maybe, like, this is, look how tall this is. Look how much time it would take to tear this all down. But what I want to do is keep all the trees and then have this whole flat area be like a forest in the water, and all these trees, I'll extend them down all the way down to the ground, and I will have all the different types of trees too. There's actually four biomes in this area even. There's a desert over here. We could see kind of the amplified desert coming up, but there's a desert in this area as well. So this area is pretty crazy. You can see that there's actually an amplified border around this area too, and I think that's awesome. I generated this area in 1.7, the Witch Hut, but then I went to the MBT files to change this world to an amplified world, and so what I had generated outside the Witch area wasn't generated yet, so when I came back and ran around the Witch Hut more, the borders of the Witch Farm became this amplified terrain. So I think it's a really cool... See, I need to light this up, because that creeper means witches, one less witch would spawn in the farm. But this amplified terrain gives this whole area a nice border. It's actually all within or outside the 128 block radius for the perimeter, except for this corner over here, which is the 110 blocks. That's why I have the actual wall at 110. So I start counting there, and then there's 110 prismarine going all the way to the end, and this is the kind of the amplified wall over here. So I want to build a wall as it is, and kind of contain this area, change the floor out to what it was over there. I might skip part of that step or do it slowly over time, because it's kind of boring. Even for me, who kind of likes the peaceful grind of Minecraft survival, it's kind of dulling out. I need to kind of take a break and do something else. So what I want from this area, aside from the witch farm, is actually to make this the richest place in my world. I want to build... I actually have this mapped out, so let's go on top. I would go above where slimes can spawn, because this is all swampland, so I need to make sure I'm above where slimes are capable of spawning in swamps. And so it'll be all above this water, so it might be like glass floors everywhere too, so you can still see beneath. And around this whole farm, there will be the wealth area, I think might be over here maybe. But it will have all my diamonds, it will have all the redstone, it will have like all the rich stuff, all the iron, all the gold, emeralds, stuff like that. And then next to it will be the enchanting area. I'll have all my fishing books here, and all sorts of enchanted stuff in the kind of a one confined area over here. And then I'll have potions on the opposite side, a potion lab of sorts, so I could brew any potion I want quick and easy. And then on the opposite side, I'll have three more I have four areas actually. So I have general storage for all the rest of the storage of this world. I would have deep space storage for blocks. So like all the dirt, like chests full and chests full, double chest full of dirt, double chest full of cobblestone, stuff like that, where you mass a large amount of dirt and netherrack and stuff. Those would be in deep space storage over here. And deep space mob loot would be over here. So all the zombie flesh I have, all the bones and stuff like that. Water bottles from the witches would go into the potion area. And then the glass area I have would be sheep and dye stuff. So all the a sheep farm would be here. And then where I could get all 16 wool, 16 glass, and 16 stained clay is a fifth. So be all my dyes and all that sort of stuff. And of course there's actually two quad beacons here, so you can see one right there. Ooh, that looks cool, this amplified terrain in the twilight. So you can see, oh yeah, there's another. So we have, that's a regular forest over there. So you have regular forest, swamp, plains, desert, that's 4, dark oak, 5, taigas, 6. So we have 6 biomes in this perimeter. I actually haven't checked that corner at all. So six biomes in this area, that's crazy. So I want to make this like the wealthiest area of my world, where all my resources would be like all storage would be like like all my other bases, all the extinct bases, the ones I never go to anymore, they'll all get their loot into this area and all be in one place for easy to use, easy to craft new stuff. And yeah, this is the newest area, the newest thing I'm working on, and that ends the tour. Five bases. No kitty, you cannot bite my fingers. All five bases. No, don't play innocent. all five bases I wanted to tour, I've toured today. There's, I think, a few little stuff, but nothing as big as those five, that's for sure, and nothing as big planned so far, aside from what I've shown you today. And that's it. This is a long video. I wanted to make it shorter, but it went long. So I appreciate you watching if you're still this far, and I'll see you in the next video.